This special edition of Siskel and Ebert is brought to you by Nestle Raisinettes. At the movies or at home, Raisinettes.
The money back right now, all of it.
A simple plan.
And what kind of nonsense is this?
Simon Birch, Dark City. What do these three films have in common? There's something about each of them that either Roger or I, or maybe both of us, thinks is worthy of an Academy Award nomination. And lobbying Oscar voters to nominate deserving films and their creators is the purpose of this annual special show we call Memo to the Academy. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. And do we want to influence the Academy?
Yes.
Okay. Let's begin with the Best Actor category. We think the likely nominees will include Tom Hanks for Saving Private Ryan and Ian McKellen for Gods and Monsters and maybe Jim Carrey for The Truman Show. For that list, I recommend the Academy add Bill Paxton for A Simple Plan. Sam Raimi's film was one of the year's best. A stark and surprisingly powerful story of three men who find $4 million in a plane crash in the woods and think they can get away with keeping the money.
I've seen you do some pretty stupid things, Jacob, but that pretty much takes the cake.
My idea.
Oh, well, that's brilliant, Lou. Now when they find the plane and they realize the money's gone, they're going to know right off who took it.
Well, that's what's cool about it, though, Hank. I mean, you know, if we wouldn't tell somebody if we were the ones that did it.
I mean, it's not like he said that you actually saw a plane going down. Just you thought you might have heard one with the engine trouble.
You want me to burn the money? I am not going to prison over this.
Bill Paxton has been in big movies like Twister and little movies like One False Move, and here he shows the complexities that he's capable of. He plays a man who finds it surprisingly easy to do things that he once could never have contemplated doing. I think he deserves an Oscar nomination, and while they're at it, the Academy could also nominate Billy Bob Thornton in the supporting category. In a time when so many movies depend on gimmicks for their appeal, A Simple Plan is simply a very well-made film.
It's so well-directed, I think the performances could get overlooked, so I'm glad you're delivering the memo. In the Best Actor category, I have an unusual choice, an actor in a horror film. And the fact that his superb performance is in a horror film is the very reason I need to send a memo to the Academy. My choice is the always entertaining James Woods for his performance in John Carpenter's Vampires. He plays a vampire hunter who gets a kick out of destroying the living dead as payback for the one who sunk his teeth into his own father.
All right, we think we got a nest inside this place. Figure on at least six goons, maybe more, and chances are we'll find a master in here somewhere. Rule number five, if you find the nest, you find the master. He usually won't leave it on its own. So it is strictly by the book today, gentlemen. Questions? Let's get to work.
He's terrific. James Woods has been nominated only once before in his career, 12 years ago, as Best Actor for Salvador. I think it's time, once again, for the motor mouth artistry and energy of James Woods to be recognized. He seems to me to be incapable of being anything less than arresting on screen. He galvanizes the violence in John Carpenter's Vampires. He gets us rooting for the home team. He is the home team. He deserves a nomination for Best Actor this year.
Well, I enjoyed the performance for what it was, but you know, it wasn't really a very good movie, and to some degree, what he does in it is pretty much within his gift. I think that he's a much better actor in a movie coming out later this month called Another Day in Paradise. And there he shows what range he has as an actor.
Well, his gift is remarkable because I don't think that there are too many actors who just take over the screen like he does when he starts talking.
Yeah, but you know, kind of, if you're going to nominate him for Best Actor, you kind of want him to be in a little better movie, don't you think?
No, I want the performance. I don't care about the movie. I care about the performance, because that's what it's called, best performance by an actor.
Okay, when we come back, our choices for best actors.
Welcome back to Memo to the Academy, the annual show in which Roger and I make suggestions to the Motion Picture Academy about who they should nominate for the Oscars this year. And looking at the Best Actress category, the front runners are Meryl Streep in One True Thing, Kate Blanchett as Elizabeth, Gwyneth Paltrow in Shakespeare in Love. But the actress that I'd like to see nominated that may have been forgotten in this category is Annabella Sciorra for her performance as the grieving widow of an accident victim, Robin Williams, in What Dreams May Come. Sciorra creates a very specific character who first mourns the loss of her children and then her husband without our losing interest in her.
You're reaching each other through her painting. It's nothing I've ever seen, Chris.
You can't see it, can you? And you never will.
Sciorra has strength, a core of steel, regardless of what happens to her characters. To me, she always has had an edgy energy that separates her from the pack. She's a presence, and she deserves to be recognized with a Best Actress nomination for What Dreams May Come, in which, think about it, her silence successfully competes with one of our most boisterous actors, Robin Williams, and with some of the most dazzling computer graphics ever put on a big screen.
Well, I agree with you. She's very good in this film, and I thought, like you did, that it was a good film. It was dumped on by a lot of critics who felt it was too sentimental, but of course they hadn't seen Patch Adams yet. This movie, it seemed to me, as you say, was visionary, and it was imaginative in its leap into this woman's mind. What conditions led her to where she got to in this film?
But to stand out.
And
with those visuals and with Robin Williams, that's a tough chore, and she does it.
She's good. My choice in this category would be the astonishing comeback by Ali Sheedy in a powerful sleeper named High Arc. Sheedy is a skilled actress. She was wonderful in a 1989 movie called Heart of Dixie, but for most people, she'll forever be identified as an erotic misfit in The Breakfast Club and the kid sister of the Brat Pack. Yet in a film named High Arc, she gave one of 1998's best performances. She plays a woman who was once a famous photographer, but who burned out and crashed and now holds up with her lover, an older German woman who lives for cocaine. And then the young magazine editor from downstairs, played by Rhoda Mitchell, comes into her life, and suddenly, once again, there is the possibility of change. Ali Sheedy has a very tricky role here. She's loyal to the older woman, attracted to the younger woman, and almost afraid to test the photographic skills she hasn't used in a decade. Can she break loose, or will she be trapped by loyalty and fear? This is a performance you simply cannot take your attention away from. The Academy should nominate Ali Sheedy for Best Actress.
It's a good choice, Roger, because this is a grown-up role, and she's always thought of as the kid sister, and she should use this film as an audition tape with casting directors. She's very good in it.
It's as good a dramatic performance as we've seen this year. When we come back, I'll provide the Academy with some of my suggestions in assorted other categories. Continuing this special show, Memo to the Academy, where we try to influence the Oscar nominations, here are four more nominations I think would be very well deserved at Oscar time. Emma Thompson plays a first lady not entirely unlike Hillary Clinton in Primary Colors, the observant political satire by Mike Nichols. It was a thankless role, playing a woman we all thought we knew, but she brought it subtle and revealing new dimensions, explaining in a way why she remained loyal to a gifted but reckless man. The Academy should nominate Emma Thompson for Best Supporting Actress. The choice for the year's Best Picture was Dark City by Alex Proyas, and the movie had brilliant art direction and visual effects, which both deserve nominations. Look at the retro noir look here, and then watch as the Dark City changes its shape in the middle of the night. Tom Hanks is sure to be nominated as Best Actor for Saving Private Ryan, but the other great performance in that movie is in danger of being overlooked. That would be Jeremy Davies, who deserves a Supporting Actor nomination as the frightened corporal, the translator who doesn't think he belongs in combat. He didn't play a macho hero, just a civilian who got drafted and found himself in the middle of things. And I'd also like to see a nomination go to Jake Kasdan for his screenplay for Zero Effect, one of the year's most ingenious and original films. It starred Bill Pullman as a brilliant but reclusive detective.
A few words on looking for things. When you go looking for something specific, your chances of finding it are very bad. Because of all the things in the world, you're only looking for one of them. When you go looking for anything at all, your chances of finding it are very good. Because of all the things in the world, you're sure to find some of them. And the most important rule, often the thing you're looking for is right in front of your nose.
Now, the handicap with some of these movies like Dark City or High Art or Zero Effect is that they weren't big winners at the box office. Right. And the Academy seems to be so locked into the winner mentality that they don't look for good work except with the box office champs.
Or also, the studios behind these pictures may not put the budget to send out cassettes to all the 5,000 Academy members. How can they nominate it?
So think how lucky the voters are that they have a program like this, which helps them figure out
and
what other movies
to look
for.
And the one that I like on your list that I want to reinforce is Jake Kasdan's screenplay. He takes, well, he basically updates Sherlock Holmes and puts him in a health club at one point in the picture. It's a very good original script. Coming up next, more suggestions from me for Oscar-worthy candidates. And now, roaming around the rest of the 24 Oscar categories, here are some of my favorite achievements that need highlighting to have any chance of getting a nomination. First, William Hurt as Best Supporting Actor to Meryl Streep in One True Thing. It's very hard for anyone to compete with Streep, particularly here, where she's playing a character who is dying of cancer. Hurt's character and performance could easily be forgotten as the man in the corner, but he has been perfectly cast as a brittle, brilliant college professor who's insensitive to the emotional needs of his grown daughter, played by Renee Zellweger.
Writer to writer.
It's a big racket.
Less is more. Your approach is a little over emotional at times. It needs to be more succinct. The word choice needs to be more muscular. Helen, you've got a great talent, but it's not enough. You have to reach.
I don't know of another actor who radiates more intelligence than William Hurt. You can see him thinking about what he says, and that thoughtfulness captures our attention because his performances are not merely mechanical recitations of dialogue. Moving on, occasionally the look of a film can be as important as any character in it. I think that's the case of the movie Elizabeth and the production design by John Meyer. He has created a vividly dark background through the vast, cold, stony spaces of 16th century England, where the intrigues of power are played out.
Mary of Guise has increased the French garrison in Scotland by 4,000 men.
Perhaps more.
Madam, I'm afraid the French mean to attack while we are still weak, and while your Majesty's reign is still uncertain.
Another recommendation, once in a while, a fresh face emerges on the big screen, and in the case of 69-year-old David Kelly, it really was his face and his scrawny naked body that jumped off the screen when he jumped on a motorcycle in the clever Irish village comedy Waking Ned Devine, one of the most delightful surprises of the year.
Do you have your ticket on you?
Will you excuse me just a minute, Jim? I have a bit of an upset tummy coming on.
Well, I can have your full name and date of birth, please, Ned.
Ned Patrick Devine.
One of the most consistently entertaining actresses working today is Ashley Judd, and this year her performance stood out in the highly emotional Simon Birch, where she played an independent small-town mother bringing up her illegitimate son without shame or explanation. Her character is a loving soul, drawn to the title character, a strange little boy who believes that God has a special purpose for each and every one of us.
I have something for you.
You made that for me?
I did indeed, my little doll. I think it's going to be getting cool pretty soon, and you need to have a beautiful sweater just for you. Hopefully, a good fit.
Judd's character becomes his de facto mother and protector without turning herself into a boring do-gooder. She is convincing as a New England woman having to deal with issues of conscience and responsibility. And for that, I think Ashley Judd deserves a nomination as Best Supporting Actress.
Oh, she's very good. And you know, of the four that you mentioned, the one I feel the most affection for is David Kelly. You know, there are some actors who make a movie just by appearing in it.
Yeah.
You can hardly imagine Waking Ned Devine without David
right.
Kelly. He is so funny, and his presence is so perfect in scene after scene that he's instrumental to the whole success of the film.
Maybe because he's so distinctive, this memo was unnecessary. The one that I really feel most strongly about is William Hurt. He will be forgotten as being in that picture, and he did a great job.
Okay, we hope the Academy is listening. Coming up next, our suggestions for Best Picture. Continuing our memo to the Academy in the Best Picture category, the front runners are probably Saving Private Ryan, Shakespeare in Love, and The Truman Show. On the basis of a lot of year-end critics awards, Gods and Monsters may sneak in too, although it's not really of Best Picture caliber, in my opinion. I know the Academy won't nominate my number one film of the year, Dark City, but I would like to see them nominate the number two film on my list, Pleasantville. This was a film that brilliantly illustrated the way new breakthroughs in special effects were being exploited in 1998. Gary Ross's film combined black and white with color in an Orwellian fantasy about young people from today being transported back into the world of a 1950s sitcom. The film started out a little like a sitcom itself, and then it got steadily deeper and more challenging and more complex. It used entertainment as the vehicle for social and political satire, and by the end, it had made a surprisingly powerful statement. Pleasantville deserves to be nominated as one of the year's best films.
I agree with you, Roger. It was high ranking on my list, too. And now we come to a film that I think is worthy of a nomination, but boy, does it need help. And I'm quite serious in suggesting to Academy members that they nominate the remarkable sequel, Babe, Pig in the City, as one of the five best films of 1998. The original story of the sheep-herding pig was a Best Picture nominee 3 years ago, and so I would ask those who voted for it to look seriously at this sequel and consider how inventive it is.
What is that, a canine? Huh? A canine? Little puppy dog?
Flatley, come back. We don't know where it's been, do we, Alan?
No, Nigel.
Feline, you're a cat?
Do I look like a cat?
I don't know if you look like a cat. I got the myopia. I can barely see a thing. Listen, if you're a cat, you got a scat. That's the rule. Hey, kitty, you got no business being on this floor. You got that? No felines on this floor. Period.
Fabulous. Director George Miller outdoes himself every few minutes in this picture by creating a magical amalgam of cityscapes in which Babe and his menagerie of friends run wild. And there is plenty of heart expressed amid the action as Babe's relationship to the other animals defines friendship and fidelity. I think a very good movie could be made about the creation of this sequel. That the original Babe was taken seriously is heartening. Voters, go for it again.
Oh, I'd love to walk right out of this theater balcony right now and see that movie again this minute. But you know what? You talked earlier about whether studios get behind movies or not and help
right.
promote them. Here's a movie that opened up against a big Disney picture and opened disappointingly. And then the studio head, Casey Silver, was fired. And as a result, this movie doesn't have the slightest chance. And it's a shame. If Babe, Pig in the City, and Dark City, if those two cities had had more viewers this year, there would have been more happy people coming out of theaters. Remember, you can check our votes and hear our reviews of recent movies at our website, Siskel-Ebert.com. Next week, we'll be back with one of our favorite shows, The Worst Movies of 1998, in which we get to take one last shot at the movies that stole precious hours from out of our lives. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.